Hi again, Pop Pickers. Another cool interview for you from another upcoming band. This time, it's Stone Sea, who are across the Irish Sea, and they currently hang out in Dublin. Tonight, we're going to be talking to their drummer, Connor Middleton. The band described themselves as alternative rock, and from what we've heard, they have elements of Nirvana and lots of those sort of grunge bands, but they're with the dual guitars, they have a much heavier sound. Anyway, check them out, and here goes with the interview.
Okay. Here we go. Oh.
Hey, how are you feeling? You okay?
All good.
That's good. That's not an Irish accent.
It is indeed.
Is it?
Yeah.
What part of Ireland are you from?
Dublin.
Dublin. Ah, of course, yeah. Yeah. It's broader, isn't it?
Yeah, a little bit. It's not as, I suppose you could say, it's not as musical as the rest of the country, you could say. It's kind of more just down the middle. Like.
I wouldn't say it's musical. There's a lot of good bands coming out of Dublin. So you're the drummer in Stone Sea.
I am indeed, yeah.
Tell us about it. I mean, how would you describe your music?
We kind of put it under the umbrella of alternative rock simply just because it is an alternative to your kind of generic rock music, I suppose you'd find, simply just because we kind of have like a stoner rock vibe, but then there's the kind of like bossa nova-y stuff and kind of jazzy bits that come into it, and then there's like kind of really like melodic and like kind of heavily melodic songs that are kind of just accented with some drums and bass and kind of like atmospheric vocals, I suppose. So I mean, I suppose if we were to really kind of label it as one thing, I'd say we'd probably say stoner rock with elements of world music is probably what we'd go with.
That's quite a description.
Yeah.
It does fit it, though. I mean, I've heard the EP a few times now, and it would be very difficult in this day and age of labelling, because you're going to get pigeonholed into, oh, this is alternative rock, this is grunge, this is, you know, you're weaving in and out of all the different genres, and credit to you for doing that, because so many bands just stick to the stick to the profile.
Yeah.
Which makes for very boring reviews, to be honest. So how long have you guys been together?
Well, Elvis, our singer and guitar player, he started the band in 2014 in Brazil, and then he moved here in 2015, and there was a different lineup initially, which recorded the first two EPs. And then I think I joined about 2 years ago now, maybe about a year and a half, 2 years ago. I think we're coming up to 2 years. So then, so the EPs were recorded. Mankind Maze was already recorded by the time I joined. It just hadn't been released. So we kind of did like a big build up for it, and then did a big launch gig here in Dublin, and kind of did like some single launches and stuff around the country. And that's kind of how that went anyway. So about 2 years, I suppose, I'm in the band. Yeah.
Yeah. And you say that the sort of germ of this band started in Brazil, of all places.
Yeah.
Which is maybe where some of the world music elements come from, do you think?
For sure, definitely, yeah. Because, I mean, Bossa Nova itself, for that song Prelude on Mankind Maze, is like Bossa Nova is a Brazilian style, I suppose, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So definitely, Elvis definitely brings that kind of world music vibe on top of like just like kind of heavy doomy riffs, I suppose, as well, you know what I mean? So he's a pretty versatile guy when it comes to his abilities as well, you know.
It makes it interesting for you as well as a drummer, doesn't it? Instead of just doing 2-4-4-4,
yeah,
you can throw some swing in there, you can have a field day, really.
Exactly.
Elements of Bill Ward, dare I say, yeah, that loose flowing drumming rather than, you know, machine drumming, as I call it. It's obviously been done on a machine of a certain brand, which we won't mention because I'm not going to give it the time of day. So were you in bands before?
Yeah, well, I think I was kind of like, I've always kind of been in a band per se. Like when I was probably around 13 or 14, I kind of just jammed with friends and like we kind of grew up playing together. And then when I was about 15, I kind of started my first, like, I'd say proper band. But by that, I mean, like, we just kind of played a few gigs and that's kind of when I would have started playing gigs. So that was kind of like rock with like kind of bits of funk, I suppose. Not like, I wouldn't be funk music, but it was kind of had like elements, like I suppose kind of like the way Stone Sea would have elements of other stuff. It kind of had like elements of funk. And then when I was like 17 or 18, I got really interested in playing metal, to be honest. Specifically, I joined like a thrash kind of death metal band, and I was in that band for about 3 years. And then we kind of like toured a little bit and kind of played all over Ireland and a good bit over the UK, and kind of did some big things, but like personality clashes and kind of ego clashes and all that kind of stuff eventually ensued, and I ended up deciding to leave the band. And once I'd left that band, like I already knew who Stone Sea were, because they kind of made a pretty good name for themselves around the scene at that time. And I'd seen Elvis kind of putting up posts and stuff looking for a drummer, and I was really interested in kind of getting back into playing rock music and stuff like that after playing metal for so long. And I just kind of shot him a message on Facebook and I was like, hey man, I'm really into the music. Do you want to meet up and jam and see what happens? And now we're here, I suppose. So that's kind of the gist of the story, to be honest.
Well, as you say, sometimes you need a break from the standard kind of drum patterns, don't you?
Yeah.
You need to do something different as a musician express yourself.
Exactly.
And I'm sure these guys are going to give you plenty of opportunity to do that with all the musical influences that they've got. The music's on Music Glue and Bandcamp, isn't it? Is it on any of the other platforms?
Yeah, we're on Spotify and Apple Music, and I think we're on Deezer as well. I feel like we are. I could be wrong there, but I'm pretty sure we're there as well.
Deezer?
Yeah.
Deezer? Oh, God. Okay, we'll forgive you for that. We'll mind you, I suppose with your different influences and the different musical styles, you can slot in there, can't you, really? So
yeah,
that makes sense. Do you say you're not the drummer on Mankind Maze?
No, that's not me on Mankind Maze, no.
Ah, so when are we going to hear some Stone Sea with you drumming?
Hopefully not too long. We'll see. Mm-hmm. We are pretty much finishing up the pre-production stage on a new album. So we have one song that's fully mixed and mastered that we will hopefully be doing a video for in the coming months. So I would imagine by September we'll hopefully have done the video. So by this year, anyway, there'll be new music for sure. And I won't say any particular dates just because nothing is nailed down, but by the end of the year, there'll be new music released for sure.
Great stuff. I look forward to hearing that. Have you guys been affected by the virus and crisis and lockdown?
Yeah, actually, sadly, we were. So the album that I was talking about, once February came around, we were pretty much done the writing process, give or take. Like, I think we were going to write 2 or 3 more songs just to kind of pick the best ones. And so once the lockdown kind of happened here, it kind of put a halt to everything. So it kind of added about 6 months to 8 months onto that schedule. And then we had some festival appearances kind of booked for, like, just kind of small independent festivals around Ireland, kind of booked for June and July. And then we actually had a 2-week run of the UK booked for the first 2 weeks of September that has had to be cancelled as well. So we had to cancel a significant, we actually had to cancel, I think, about in total about 16 or 17 gigs. And then like pre-album production and stuff like that got put on hold, and our ability to gig has obviously gone. So kind of a lot of the funds that we were going to have that was going to pay for the album are kind of gone as well. So we're just going to have to wait and see what happens, to be honest, and just kind of take it as it comes. And once government guidelines kind of give us the go ahead that live music can kind of happen, and, you know, social distancing might necessarily have to be as much of a big thing and gigs can happen, well, we'll see how it goes. But for the foreseeable, that doesn't really look possible, so we just kind of got to take it as it comes.
No, has it really decimated the Irish music scene as much as it has over in England?
I mean, I know a lot of bands are affected by it, and I mean, of course, we're not the only band, and I to be honest, I can't imagine that we have been the worst affected as well. I'd say there's a lot of bands that have probably been affected way worse than we have as well. You know what I mean? personally, I know I have some friends that kind of just had to cancel some gigs and stuff. And I know some friends were meant to play Bloodstock this year, and obviously that's gotten pushed back to next year now. So I know that they're pretty disappointed about that. And, you know, things just kind of, but everyone's kind of in the same boat. So it's kind of like a community, I suppose, you know what I mean? So once everything kind of gets back up and running, I feel like everyone will be back doing it. You know what I mean? I don't think that it's going to die. I just feel like once it's, once it can be back up and running, I feel like it's going to just, it's like a sprint. You know what I mean? Everyone's just going to be, boom, let's go. Like, you know what I mean? So I think it'll be okay.
Great stuff. You can't kill rock and roll, to say the cliche. Who would you say are your personal musical influences?
Now, my friend Michael actually made a playlist with a lot of kind of older blues songs and some like kind of like bit of Guns N' Roses and Aerosmith. I've been listening to a lot of that. So lately I've been listening to a lot of kind of Eric Clapton and some JJ Cale and a lot of Aerosmith as well. But I suppose in my more kind of like formative years in playing, I would have been a big kind of like fan of the 90s grunge scene. So kind of like Alice in Chains, Nirvana, and Soundgarden and stuff. And then when I found out that Dave Grohl was the drummer in Nirvana and the singer in Foo Fighters, I had this like epiphany moment, and I was like, holy shit, man, this guy is like multitasking. Like, and I kind of became a really big fan of Foo Fighters, and then kind of independently a big fan of Dave Grohl just as a person and kind of all that stuff. And then once I kind of got a little bit older, I got more into metal, so I kind of started listening to like Metallica and Slayer, and then kind of got into some heavier stuff like a little bit of Obituary and kind of stuff like that as well. But my tastes have kind of lightened now, I suppose. I kind of had this, like, I suppose, when I kind of think about it, it was kind of like probably like that angsty phase people go through. But I had it at like 17 to like 20, where I was just like listening to metal exclusively. And I was like, no, it's not for me. I don't want to listen to any of that stuff from now. I mean, it's very rare that I still like metal, and there's kind of like, I'm still a big fan of like Gojira and stuff. But it's very rare that I'd kind of sit around and just listen to metal anymore, unless someone is showing me something or I just kind of happen to come across this insane song where I'm like, wow, I can't stop listening to this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes something just grabs you, and doesn't matter what genre it is, as long as it makes your heart beat faster, that's all that really matters.
Exactly.
Usually we have a bit of fun when we do interviews, and we do this section that we call Six Appeal.
Okay.
And it's six questions that we pick in the office at complete random.
Okay.
So we are pretty mental. So we're capable of coming up with some very sensible questions and some really fucking stupid ones.
Okay.
But anyway, these are the ones that have been thrown out of the barrel this evening.
Okay.
What's your funniest ever moment?
Ever. Ooh. I can actually talk about, now it's funny, at the time it wasn't funny. So I was on tour with my old band. I'll keep it, I suppose, with the music, because this is a pretty funny story. And we were playing in a bar in Warrington. I think that's just between Manchester and Liverpool, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
I can't remember what bar it was. I'm not quite sure, but we were in Warrington anyway. And all of the guys in the band, we were kind of like, we were like pretty like keeping it as cheap as possible, but the promoter brought us to this like kebab place around the corner and was like, this is really nice. Like, and we were like, all right, cool. It's like, we'd kind of been eating just Subway and like Asda sandwiches for like days, 'cause we were pretty broke, and we were just like kind of thankful to have to eat something hot, to be honest. So we went and got these kebabs, and at the time they were nice. And then this was probably like 2 or 3 hours before the gig, and the like opening bands were like playing, and I was kind of like feeling a bit of an upset stomach, and I was like, what's going on right now? Like, I was like, this is a, I was kind of like trying to ignore it. I was like, maybe I just, to be honest, I was kind of thinking maybe I just need to fart or something or burp. I was like, I'm sure I'll be fine. And then I was chatting to the bass player at the time, Daz, and I was like, man, I feel weird. Like, and he was like, yeah, I feel really weird as well. Like, and it's like, I kind of feel like there's something fucking bubbling here. I was like, this does not feel normal, man. And, the five of us ended up having to like sprint sadly to the bathroom before the gig and kind of just get out of us what we could get out of us, because it was kind of like, I mean, this sounds so disgusting, but it was kind of both ends, like, and like we were meant to go on and play a gig, and I mean, Jesus Christ, like, now that I think about it, trying to remember that, it was actually horrible at the time. We kind of just beelined for the bathroom and we're like, right, just get this, just see what we can do. It ended up being like the worst gig I've ever played, just because, like, trying to play at like 200 BPM when, like, there's, you know, some severe stomach cramps going on is, I wouldn't recommend it. And I actually wouldn't wish it upon my worst enemy. It was a horrendous time, man, to be honest.
The joys of being on the road.
Yeah.
Would you rather be in a pub in Ireland, or would you go with the boys to Brazil?
Oh, I'd go to Brazil.
Yeah.
Oh, without question.
Bloody warmer.
Yeah. Without question. You wouldn't even need to think twice about it.
Wow. Saying no great ties to the island there.
Well, I love Ireland, but, like, I like adventure. When an opportunity arises where I can go and experience something that I've never experienced before, I'm normally very open to the idea, because I'm a big believer in experiences in life that you've never, like, experiencing something new in life is what enables you to grow. And kind of when you stick to a routine and it kind of becomes a bit monotonous, as much as you can get stuff done, it's like, I'd feel kind of like I'm halted, I suppose, in like a routine. And when I do something new, I always find my outlook can change, or maybe just my attitude in general about certain things can change. And if I went to Brazil, and from what Elvis has told me, and I actually had a friend, Michael, that went to Brazil last year, who's told me a lot about it, I feel like it'd be a really eye-opening experience, especially compared to how living in Ireland is, you know what I mean? It's a whole new continent, and it'd, Brazil, no question. Wow.
You never know, do you? Strange things can happen. Jeans or jogging bottoms?
Jeans.
Good answer.
Yeah.
Do you like pickled eggs?
I don't think I've ever had one.
Then you can't answer that question.
I suppose I can't.
Would you consider trying a pickled egg?
Of course. All about those new things.
Well, if you ever want those stomach cramps again, that's the product for you.
Okay, maybe not. We'll see. If an opportunity arises, I'll experiment a little bit. I'll see what happens.
Just not before a gig.
Yeah, most definitely not before a gig.
Yeah. Do you have any pets?
I don't. I've been trying to get a dog. I still live at home with my mother and my sister, and I've been trying to convince her to get a dog for about 10 years. And that's not even a lie. I mean, 10 years and it's just not happening. So,
maybe when you get a place around, the first thing you can do is get a dog.
Without question.
Yeah.
It's already in the brain. It's already there. I just know it's happening. So,
what sort of dog would you like?
I'd love a Rottweiler, but get it from a puppy and have it for its whole life. Then, I think that'd be great.
Yeah, they're such good dogs. They're such loyal dogs.
Yeah.
And final question, which is more sensible. What age did you start drumming?
Oh, I think I was I started playing seriously where, like, I was probably practicing like 3-4 hours a day from the age of 13 or 14. But I would have started teaching myself anyway when I was around 11, 12. So I kind of played like... I would have probably practiced every like couple of days when I was like between the ages like 11 to 13. And then once I kind of went into secondary school, and I just kind of got like such motivation to just play as much as I could. So like about 11, but like seriously, like taking it serious in terms of practice, about 14, probably.
How old are you now?
I'm 22.
Right, I'm only a kid.
Yeah.
I mean, you make me feel so fucking old. if you could give some advice to a young drummer just starting out, what would you say to them?
Well, the one thing I would say from my experience is the blisters are normal and they will stop eventually. Because that was something that used to freak me out when I was playing. And now they're all calluses and I haven't probably gotten a blister in 4 years, but... At the start, it's kind of just fight through the blisters and it'll work. Just keep practicing. Even an hour a day, or like just practice, because like I remember being like 13, 14, wanting to do what I'm doing now in bands. even act like I'm not even talking, and like obviously the dreams of the big scale and, you know, the stadiums and everything is obviously there, but when it comes to just what the basic idea was, like, I remember being like 13, 14, being like, I really want to play a gig in a bar, you know what I mean? And I'm kind of doing, I had done that by the time I was like 15, and then now, you know, I've kind of toured with, even not with Stone Sea, but just in general, and I've kind of got some, I've got studio experience, and I've kind of done the like first time of everything that I'd always dreamed about, at least, you know what I mean? So I feel like as long as you put the work in and the effort and you really want to do it, I think that's good enough, and you'll just reap the rewards of the effort you put in, to be honest.
Absolutely. Well said.
Thanks.
Well, thank you very much, Connor, and we wish you all the best with Down Sea, and we hope all this nonsense fucks off so you can get, we can see you live. And if you do come over to the Midlands, we do have kebabs that don't give you the shit, we promise.
Excellent. I'll make sure to try it. Well, I'll think about it. I'll actually
think about it. Yeah. Ring us first and we'll tell you some places that are safe.
Of course, we will do.
Okay. Thank you, Connor. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.